was ruled by Britain and Egypt. They ruled together and colonized it until Sudan became its own sovereign nation in 1955. When Egypt and Britain left, they left the country in turmoil because what they did is they left the power up to one group. As I shared earlier, there was a divide between religions, and the majority group that took power was the northern region because that's where the capital was. And so the southern didn't feel like they were represented very well at all in the government. And that led them to, Sudan's been in two civil wars. That first civil war started a year later when Britain and Egypt left because of that same thing where there was no representation at all of the southern people. And then that war lasted until 1972 with the treaty, the Addis Ababa Agreement, which was signed in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, between the president and then also he wasn't the president of the South, but John Grun, and he was the leader of SPLMA, which is just it's basically a people movement. Misuse of power. What happened was the person in power, he ruled Gafar Umar. The treaty lasted for a long time. There was an actual equal and compromise until 1983, when he declared that Sudan would become an Islamic nation. Now, there's nothing wrong with that if the country is predominantly all Islam. There's nothing wrong with that whatsoever. The issue with that is that the Christians, again, didn't believe that. And so to demonstrate his power, and what he did was, in the middle of the capital, he poured out all the liquor and every alcohol that was possible, just to show that, because in Islam, they don't believe in alcohol or drinking. So he poured out everything, and that caused an uproar and caused the second civil war. This is where I come in. First off, you gotta have parents to be creative. So my father, his name is Jay. He was born in Pachala. Pachala is on the Sudanese side, next to the border of Sudan and Ethiopia. In this area, when the first civil war started, he was in school in his village and such. But those schools began to shut down in the area because there wasn't enough teachers and there's just too much turmoil. So his parents, advised him that he should move to the capital city of Khartoum and go to school. And in order to pay for school, he actually joined the military, like most of us do here in the United States. My mother, her name is Elizabeth. She was born near the border of Ethiopia. She was on the Ethiopian side of the border, and they're really next to each other. She had actually been arranged to be married at 15 years old. Her aunt seen this and said, "No, I don't want you to be married. I want you to attend school and finish school and make a better life for yourself." So her aunt took her, and they moved to the capital city also of Khartoum, and that's where my parents met and eventually created us. life before camp. So before I was born, I have an older brother who was 3 years older, so he was born before me. And then in 1992, 3 years later, after he was born, I was born. And this was 9 years after that second Civil War had begun. My father had been in the military for years, so we actually lived a good life. We lived in the city. We had regular beds that you would have here. Everything was all good. We had all the necessities that anyone else had, and it was a really good life. Well, that second civil war really caused an uproar, and my father seen that he didn't want to be in this forever, and he thought that I should get a better life for my children. I don't want to be in this anymore, and the way of life was kind of crumbling, and it was changing. So we left Sudan in 1995, when I was 3 years old. The day that we left, my father took out his military check and all the earnings and everything that he had saved up, and he bought things for our journey. He bought clothing, he bought anything else, necessities that we needed. And because you're going to be traveling a long distance, you don't have the luxury of carrying everything you own. So basically what they did in some of the was they fit everything in two large trash bags, and that was our clothing or anything else that we needed around the house. So you can imagine now having a six-year-old at the time and a three-year-old, and everything that you own in your house is now fitting into two trash bags, and you're going to have to go across the country. So our journey, how it began, was we're in the capital city of Khartoum. So the first thing we had to do was we wanted to get near to the border. So my dad had gained enough respect and had enough people that he had made connections with. So we're able to take a military plane from the capital city of Khartoum, which is kind of like in the middle, to Pachala. And Pachala is just near the border of where we need to go. Because if you walk that, you would never ever get anywhere. It's just going across, basically trying to go across the country from Minnesota here to California, and just not doable. But once we got to Pachala, it's still far away from our destination. Although these two seem very close to each other, there's this large river dividing it called the Okobi River. And you can't just walk across and be done. So what you had to do is you had to backtrack and go around and then come up into Benito, which is that place right there, and that's where the camp is located. That took us actually a total of 3 days. And imagine now having little children, you can't go as fast as you would like. So we would take a lot of rest. We'd only be walking at night, just in fear of everything that was going on in the war and such. And then we had to take more rest than anyone else. There was other people along the journey with us that were also going to the neighboring country of Ethiopia, but they could go a lot faster than we could. So once we got into Ethiopia and Benito, we stayed with family, and we kind of gathered ourselves, and the process took a year before we actually decided that we were gonna check into the refugee camp. So we stayed with people in neighboring villages around this area. But once we actually got enough, we built ourselves up and we wanted to go to the camp, it was a 2-hour car ride to register. You had to go to the capital city of Dumbella, which is here, to register to come to the camp. The refugee camp itself. First off, what is a refugee? Surrealist, people who are forced to flee for safety from their country of origin due to war, fear, or persecution, or famine. And that's exactly what we were. The camp that I stayed in was called Block 12 and is located in Benito, Ethiopia. So one of the things that when you first start there, they give you a few, because there's so many people leaving and such large numbers, they give you basic necessities. The first few things they give you are, you get buckets of water, you get some blankets just to keep you warm and such, and then you get this food ration card because there's not enough food for everyone in the camp. And how this food ration card actually works is, you can see now the 12 months, and then these are the dates. And you have to, not everyone gets a card. When you registered, you were given a certain amount, and you wrote down how much family members you had, how many people you had with you, and that's one person held the card, and they would use that card to buy food for everyone.
What would you do if you lost the card?
If you lost the card, I think you could, I was very young at the time, so I don't know the exact, I didn't have the card, but I think they would, it's very important that you have it, so I think they would, you just have to re-register and show that you're not just trying to keep two of them, so then you would re-register and they'd probably give you a new one. And the big thing about this is, in the next slide, this is what the card gave you. It gave you wheat, beans or peas, oil, corn soy blend, and then salt. None of that came pre-made at all. It was things that you had to try to make yourself and how you can make food out of it. The nutritional value, if you can imagine, that's 726 calories compared to 900 calories. And that's the big difference there, is because here in the United States we can have meat. There's not enough meat to be able to provide for everyone, so you have to find your nutrition other ways. The way my father was describing it was, if you say you had oil or such things, what you would do is you'd go to the neighboring cities, because you were allowed to leave the refugee camp, but you had to come back by a certain time because you had an identification card. You would go and you would make trades, and you would try to find people who would give you meat for your oil. And you would have either sometimes fish, or if they had other meats, you could also have that, like chickens. But in the camp itself, you were not given that necessity.
I want to stop for a second. If you want to write notes down as you go for questions at the end, that would be great, just so you don't forget.
Oh, I'll send you sure. All right. Now, one big thing besides just food to survive is you need water. As I mentioned earlier, you were given two buckets. So you had one large one. This one's bigger. And then you had one small one. And now, this big one, if you guys want to pass it around, this is not a 12-gallon, but you can imagine.
That's only 5 gallons of water.
Cool. That's only 5 gallons. So you get, just put that in perspective, and then you pass this one around too.
And how far did you have to carry that water to your, from the pump to your home?
It would be, I think it would be about, it wasn't the camp itself, like they had wells inside the camp, but if you, say if you used up all your water, then you were walking, I guess, my the way my parents told me was you were walking up anywhere from like a 2 hour journey with water, because that was the nearest water source, if you missed your chance to get water. So every morning at the camp, you would line up, there would be huge lines of people trying to line up to get water. And they would fill, a 12-gallon jug, and that 12-gallon jug was used for your everyday, for cooking and everyday necessities, whatever you needed around the house. And then the 5-gallon jug, the smaller one out of the buckets, you would use that to fill for showering. And if you ran out of water, then you would make your journey and your walk, and you would have to go get water. But it wasn't at the camp anymore because they had to make sure they had enough.
Did they, was it usually the men that got the water, or did the women?
I think the way my parents told me was it was the women who went to go get it, and they carried it back. Now, housing also a big thing. You had to build your own house. There was, in some camps, there are tents that you can stay in, but in the one, when we were first in the camp, they had, you had to build your home. So you found wheat or barrel or just even bamboo or anything else you could find from trees, and you had to create your own house out of that. And you also had to make your own beds and everything else like that. And there's no plumbing, there's no electricity in these homes. It literally simply looks like this. And one of the big things my dad told me was a flashlight was a huge deal. And you would try to also make trades for that, because flashlight would help you see around the house because you couldn't see otherwise. There's nothing as soon as it turns dark. In our house that we had, it wasn't just us that lived there. At the time, it was my parents and then my older brother and I. So there's four of us. But we also had my dad's kids' brother, so my cousins also lived with us, and there was two of them. So imagine, we had to build a house big enough for six people. And it's not like a double decker, like you go upstairs, downstairs. This is just one huge room that everyone can just sleep on the floor or on beds if you made them. Daily life for adults. So besides just, you need something to do around the camp. What adults did was, if they hadn't built the house yet, they'd work around the house, see what they can do. If also that'd be time to go and go to the town and get food for your family if you need it, or they would go wash clothes, because, and there's no laundry mats, no washer, dryers, anything else like that. You would find a nearby, luckily it doesn't rain much, but you find a nearby place just to be able to wash your clothes, and that's what kind of the adults did. And also if they weren't doing that, then they would sit around and they would just kind of just share, tell stories, just share their experiences and just be a community in that. The children, for us, the UN was great about it. They put on school. And so I was in preschool at the time, I was little, but they still had school for us. And all I remember was, in school, they would try to make you feel really good about being at the camp, just because as a child, you know, you don't know what's going on. So they would give us like cookies every day, and that's the number one thing I remember from being at the camp, just always receiving cookies from my teachers and how big of a deal that was every single day. Besides just being in school, we would do what other kids do. We'd probably play soccer, just run around the wild and do whatever we can. So just those hardships in the camp made it really, really difficult. Just one story that I also remember is, at the time, my mom became pregnant with our third child. But she was supposed to have twins, and the camp and the and just not having enough nutrition and just the hardships of it made it really hard for her to carry both children all the way. And so during the camp, actually, one of the kids passed and didn't make it, and then one was born. So now at this time, there's a total of five of us, just in my immediate family, because three kids and then two parents. And so my parents seen that as, we need to get out of here. We're in the refugee camp for 2 years. And what you can do when you're at the refugee camp is you can file for this thing called resettlement. And resettlement basically, it's basically like a job application. application. If you can remember just going through a job and what you have to do, the first thing you have to do is you have to fill out the forms. After that, once you fill out the forms, and the forms, what they were is you would tell your story. You would tell them what brought you here to this refugee camp. How did you get here to this point? Describe to us the things that were going on in your country so that they could see and actually know who was deserving of that. After they had filed through the many stories, they would call people back for an interview process. And there was actually a series of three interviews that you had to do. And you had to be on point. I remember my mom training me and putting me in my best clothes that we had and making sure, hey, you hit these points, you know, make sure to smile, do eye contact, because it was such a huge deal that you present that as, we need to get out of here. We gotta something gotta change. So we passed those also, all those three interviews. After you pass the three interviews, you are given what is called a checkup. And so to be clear, in the United States, they have big deals about medicine and such things, so they have to see that you're healthy enough to be able to come here and you don't have any diseases that you're carrying. So what we did was we had to go to the capital town of Gambela, which is a 2-hour car ride, again, like I shared earlier, and we had to get vaccinations, we had to get all these just medical clearances to make sure that we're okay. The only setback of that was my older brother above me, he had, I think he had skin eczema. So what the doctors just told him is that if you take this cream and use this cream for a little bit, the skin eczema will disappear and you'll be fine, you guys will be clear. So we went through that process, he was finally cleared up, and then we were moved on to the next thing. And the next step after the checkup is they tell you where you're going. They tell you about the location you're going, about what's gonna be there. The location that we were given to go was, first off, they find sponsors wherever the locations are. The United States has a really great program with allowing a lot of refugees here. Europe has a lot of programs also, and then that's about it. So our location that we're given was Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. Well, I don't know the difference. I'm just a small kid. We don't care. We're just like, get us out of here any way we can. So we boarded the plane out of Ethiopia once we were cleared and we were given a location, everything else like that. And we had to go to the capital city again to leave from there because there's no airport or anything in Benito. And so there's five total of us who boarded on the plane. My father, Jay, my mother, Elizabeth, my older brother, Friday, me, and then the twin that survived Opio. We arrived in the United States on September 3rd, 1998. The first place that we actually arrived, like most people, is New York City. New York. And along the way, the UN has a great process of making sure, because no one's ever been on a plane, this is something new to you. So along the way, what they would do is they have clearances, and they have people there like, hey, get on this plane, get on that plane. DOB, and that's when they finally give you your final check and go, okay, this is where you're going to be going. You're going to be going here. So in New York, we're given a new assignment. Actually, we're told that we would not be going to Oklahoma City anymore. We would actually be going to Atlanta, Georgia. And again, we didn't know any difference, and we were fine, totally fine with that. So our next place that we went is Georgia. And then eventually we migrated into Minnesota. So the first reaction is just the United States. It's something completely new and out of your element. There's this thing called, I'm right now studying intercultural communication, and there's this thing called the U-curve, which is just what all immigrants and refugees go through. As you can imagine, you start up here, and then you dip down, and then you come back up. So that first step of the U-curve is anticipation. And when I anticipated what the United States was like, I didn't know anything about it. I was just like, anything is better than here. Reality hit, go down here, when you have to speak a new language. Although I was in preschool and they didn't teach us English classes or anything else like that, they were just kind of just keeping us entertained. So I didn't know the language at all, and when you come to the United States, every child has to go to school. And I remember being in school just confused and sitting there like, I don't know this language, I don't know what's going on. And kids easily manipulated me. They would tell me like, hey, go do this and do that. And I was actually a troublemaker because I was new to this country, and they took advantage of that. And so I ended up actually being held back, and I failed first grade, and that was my first ever experience of being in the United States. How I bounced back, though, was adjustment, and that I started beginning, I was in ESL classes first all the way till probably like third grade, and that's why you guys hear me now speaking English as if it's normal. You probably would have never known that I would have failed because I didn't know English. The next big thing again is the W curve. The W curve is just like what happens to refugees and immigrants when they come here. How is it the assimilation process? What is it that they do? How do they accustom themselves? So my parents, they're completely separate from I am. As Amanda was sharing earlier, you have to, when you first come here, you have a sponsor, but then they help you find jobs. My dad, he found a job working in a restaurant because that's mostly what refugees and immigrants can do. So he, although he was interacting with the people around him, he wasn't really understanding culture. He just seen it as a necessity in a way for his family to provide for his family and have food. My mom, she would stay home because that now we have, there's three of us total, or of kids, and so she had to help around the house though. And while we were in Georgia, they also had another child. So now there's four total boys. What that process is called then, since they weren't really immersing themselves in the culture at all, they were separating themselves because they valued their culture and they wanted to keep their culture so much intact because it was such a big thing that this is what we've grown up to. The United States is not going to change us. We're sticking with it. This is how we're going to survive because our culture is very important to us. So they're separating themselves from the host culture, which is the American culture. I, on the other hand, was completely different. We're in school. We're watching television. Our friends are speaking English. It became very easy to pick up on the culture when you're immersed in it all day, every day. And so what mine was, but besides just integrating with friends and being out outside of like the social group, I had to come back home and it was still a culture of this is how we have, our culture is this culture still. So what I did was integration. I valued both cultures and I basically mixed it into one of my own. So as you know, as you shared, I'm from Georgia. Now coming from Sudan is anywhere from, or Africa in general, is anywhere from 100 degrees, it's very, very warm, it's very, very hot. So I was excited when I first came to Georgia, and I was like, and then it's known as Hot Atlanta because it gets so hot up there. And I was like, all right, cool, I can do this. Well, my parents decided we need to move to Minnesota. And I don't know why they would do that, because that is the complete opposite, where it's negative 40 all the time, and it snows. And I have no clue what this snow thing is. But there's a reason. It's called the Migrant Network. And as you can see here in Mankato, we actually have a lot of refugees and a lot of immigrants. And you wonder that why? Because their family members are already here. A lot of them already, when they're speaking to family members back home in Africa, they're telling them about, hey, I live in Mankato. Mankato is an awesome place. They have a lot of people helping you. They have refugee services. They have great healthcare. They have all these events that you can get yourself involved in. So my parents were speaking to family back here in Minnesota, and they seen that as a great opportunity. Hey, we've gotten ourselves on our feet. We've paid back our plane fees. We're well established. Why not check this out, and why not move to Minnesota? And so they moved us to Minnesota 2 years later. And there's also, I'm part of the Anuak group from South Sudan. And so there's a lot of Anuaks in Minnesota, and that's why they decided to move us here. So, and that's it.
That's a great story.